Tahrir Square, the Maidan uprising in the Ukraine, the Gezi Park protests here in Turkey, Occupy Wall Street, the Umbrella Revolution in Hong Kong. All of these things represent movements that were enabled by social media and technology, and in many important ways, they either fell short or people felt like they could have been more effective. I believe that there are some key reasons why these movements have failed to reach their full potential, and I think it has a lot to do with learning to use the tools that are in our pocket. And I don't mean being able to use the user interface or the apps on your phone. What I'm talking about is the data that lies underneath. And I think what it really boils down to is maps. No, not this kind of map. This is a geographic map. This obviously is very helpful for understanding the geography of a place like Istanbul, or figuring out how to get from point A to point B, or seeing how streets or roads or buildings are laid out. What I'm talking about is maps of relationships. This is a map of my hometown of Baltimore, Maryland, about 30 miles from Washington, D.C. And one of the things that you can see on this map is that people are segregated. People tend to organize themselves racially, and you can see that on the left end of the map, you have African Americans and Latinos, and on the far to the right of the map, you see primarily white people. You also see the TEDx crowd on the far right, white end of the spectrum, as well as geeks and people in the media and politics. And then you also see that sports act as a connecting tissue between people that are primarily concerned with urban culture and music and are probably younger and still getting established, and people who are already very established and part of the civic culture in the city. So I've started to map other cities as well. This is San Francisco. And you can see some other patterns emerge here. In San Francisco, you might imagine that there's a large quantity of technology people and people involved in the startup community. And in fact, they appear very large at the top, the community of geeks up there. And those folks are almost crowding out people in other parts of the networks. You can see there's also a group of people that's big enough to be identified as a group of Twitter employees, right next to the gamers, and then to the foodies, and the LGBT community, and arts, and music, hip-hop, and then sports off to the side, kind of the opposite of Twitter employees. And you can see that this has created some tension in the city. You see graffiti like this turning up, where people are basically expressing frustration over the fact that rents and other prices of living in San Francisco have skyrocketed dramatically as a result of the influx of venture capital investment. This is Rio de Janeiro. I did this map a couple of weeks ago for TED Global, which was held in Rio de Janeiro. One of the things that you can see here is that there's a lot more mixing in the middle of the cultures, but at the same time, you still do have a big lobe of geeks down here, sort of the TEDx Rio crowd is down here, sort of opposite of the folks that are up in the favelas up here. And then a variety of different music fans, flamenco football team, some gospel music over here. People cluster around things that they have a common interest in. So I thought it would be interesting to map Istanbul. And what you can see here, each dot here, by the way, this is not a geographic map, that should be clear, but each dot represents a person, and each line represents a relationship between people. So when you click follow, you make a line. And each color represents a community of people within the network. So we can basically take an entire city and start to separate it out into these component parts and see how people organize themselves. So on this end of the spectrum, that's you guys, primarily, I think. The earliest Twitter users, TEDx Istanbul is right on the far corner here, right about there is TEDx Istanbul. And then various brands, media. This group also has the heaviest iOS usage. And this was the first part of the network to form in Istanbul. So in terms of Twitter users, this was the first group of people that joined Twitter. After that, you have another group that seems to represent more conservative and religious and political tweets. This seems to be kind of the voice of the ruling party. as you might guess. And they're primarily repeating content, I am told, from Zaman and Saman Yolu. So as we're in this group, there tends to be a lot more diversity of sources and people sort of, you know, sharing links on their own. This seems to be repeating a lot more content. Over here, we have sports, primarily football. This pattern appears a lot in different cities. We saw it in Baltimore, we've seen it in Rio. I've seen it in a bunch of other cities that I've analyzed. And sports are interesting because they act kind of like a connective tissue. Everybody's sort of interested in sports. Some people are really interested in sports, but it usually lies somewhere towards the center of the network. Now, newer to the network is this group. These are young men, mostly frustrated young men, who really, really want girls to like them, and they write poetry to prove it. And we were pretty astonished to find this low, but they turn up other places too. And I think that what you see here is really just kind of indicative of what we actually see in the culture. You know, there's a lot of young men in the culture, and they're, you know, concerned about their future, and they want to get married, and all the above. You know, who doesn't? That's a very human thing, but you can see that they cluster together, and they tend to take pictures of themselves that look kind of like Justin Bieber, and they write a lot of poetry and share it with each other. It's interesting. Down here, or up on this end, we have another interesting group of people. This seems to be primarily inorganic traffic. There's some guy named Semi Verol, who I don't know, but apparently he's running some sort of follow-back sort of thing to try to generate fake followers and tweets for people, apparently across this entire spectrum, because they're connected into a bunch of folks, not least which is probably this group of young men. But you know, it's kind of an indicator that there are people that are on the network sort of doing things, maybe to make money, maybe trying to somehow or another amplify other people's message. We should probably treat that group with a little bit of suspicion. Down here, we have another group of young adults writing about their lives, both men and women. And they seem to be sort of in an underdog stance. They seem to have kind of a, you know, poetic, you know, desire to break past whatever the barriers that they're facing right now. They're not unlike these guys, but I think that they might have their act a little bit more together. And lastly, the newest part of the network that we discovered is this folks up here, these folks talking about sex generally and gay porn specifically. And you can see that they're not exactly central to the rest of the network. They're also exactly opposite of the conservative religious political views. Really very diametrically opposed. So what can we learn from this? And unfortunately, my top title has been removed from the slide, but there's a fellow named Sandy Pentland, who is a professor at MIT, who I actually had the pleasure of spending some time this weekend with at TEDx Beacon Street in Boston. And he's at MIT at the Media Lab, and what he studies is patterns of communication within social networks, not just human social networks, but also within other species, so things like bees and stuff like that. And what he has found is that there are patterns of healthy communication, and you can actually identify what healthy networks look like and what unhealthy networks look like. And a healthy network is characterized by short and frequent communication, by a high degree of participation across the network, and typically lots of links between all different parts of the network so that it's a very tightly meshed network. You look for acknowledgement so that, you know, when somebody says something, other people say, oh, yeah, I agree, or I don't agree, or, you know, they can at least converse that way. And then continuous exploration. And this is the idea that one part of the network doesn't stay isolated to itself. It's always looking for other parts of the network to try to connect to. And that's really important because what that means is that people are trying to find voices that are different from their own. And we'll come back to that in a minute. At the opposite side of the spectrum, you can see that all of the opposite things of the healthy patterns are, in fact, unhealthy. But there's another really interesting finding that his group has uncovered along with other people working in the field, and that is that human brains are actually permanently altered by existing in unhealthy network communication environments. And that's really important to note because what ends up happening is if you actually, you know, raise a child in an environment that doesn't value exploration and doesn't value finding new ideas, they will perpetuate that into their adulthood and raise their own children that way. That's really important to pay attention to. So if you come back again to look at Istanbul through that lens, then I would apply these value judgments to it, completely subjectively based on my study of the data, but I think other people would look at these and come to similar conclusions. This group up here, I would say, is relatively healthy because it's probably kind of been, sort of coalescing the longest. But at the same time, it needs to explore more. This group is very isolated. The fact of the matter is that you guys are in a big filter bubble. Being down here on this end of the network, you guys need to talk to these guys. And that's true in most cities. You know, we are isolated into our own networks. This group down here I would characterize as somewhat unhealthy because of the fact that there's too much broadcast traffic and not enough two-way communication amongst the different parties, and not enough exploration here either. The sports group I'm going to call healthy. They sit in the middle, and they're connecting people, and everybody's got a stake kind of in that, it looks to me like. Maybe they should talk about other things too, but in fact, you know, if you think about it as a kind of connective tissue for a city, it's probably serving a valuable function. These groups look like they're pretty healthy down here too. Maybe some more exploration is needed, but on this end of the spectrum, they're newer to the network. It's hard to say kind of where that's going. We'll see how that evolves over time. I would say that these folks need to explore more. They're probably just young, and they will explore more. But that raises an interesting question too, which is that as these folks begin to explore, where are they going to connect into? Are they going to connect into your group of people? Are they going to connect into this group or this group? Or where are they going to go? These folks, I think we can just ignore. They'll probably eventually burn out and go away. But it is interesting to think about a group of people that is really focused just around reflecting a message and what effect that could have on things like movements and uprisings, et cetera. And then this over here, the gay porn. I believe that, you know, besides for, you know, subject matter wise, you know, it is what it is, but I believe that that's a symptom of culture pushed underground, and I believe that you really only see this in places where restrictions force people to start to try to do things in different ways, and this kind of stuff pops out as a result because it exists everywhere. So, just to offer another example of that, this is a preliminary map I'm working on of Saudi Arabia, and you can see the same thing happens here with the gay porn. You can see football, they got two different teams, they're on opposite sides of things, as you might expect. And then you also have this spectrum that runs from artists and females and tolerance and liberal thinking to the religious quotes. And then you have another interesting group up here, marketer poets. I always find them interesting. But you can see that the same kind of structure applies in Saudi Arabia as you see in Istanbul as well. So a few thoughts. I believe that self-determination really does rest on our ability to map, to measure, and to shape our social networks. And I think this is a really important point to remember, because if we don't start to map and shape and understand our social networks, other people will. Governments, companies, a variety of people who you may or may not want in charge of your destiny. And in fact, if we really want things like the uprisings that have occurred around the world to take hold, we have to have a better understanding of our social networks. So, I think one of the things that's important to understand is that Twitter and Facebook and WhatsApp and all of the other data platforms, you know, the cell phone companies, banks, all sorts of people have data that's relevant to informing this discussion of just understanding the structure of the networks in our cities. But companies like Twitter and Facebook, they're concerned about engagement, right? They want to keep you on their site as long as possible. They're concerned about showing you people that are like you so that you spend more time on the site and click on their stuff. In some ways, in order to create the kind of healthy networks that Sandy Pentland describes, we need to have an exploration-based recommendation engine. We need to have recommendation engines that say, you should be friends with this person because they're totally unlike you. And that's something that's very lacking right now in the discussion. And I can tell you from having talked with people at Twitter and Facebook that they care about this, but it's not their top priority right now. And I think that the key thing that we start to have to do as users of these services is to start to ask for this data in some way where we can start to be informed by it rather than just be ruled by it. In another important way, understanding our networks is kind of like the new journalism. As journalism starts to fade and our ability to sort of use journalism to explore new ideas and to connect us with what's happening in our city, because journalism's budgets are going away and they've kind of lost their business model, we need to start to learn to use raw sources of data to try to understand how our cities work more effectively. And it's a little bit of a stretch right now to say that you can just look at this data and replace it, you know, journalism with this. We're far from there. But the fact of the matter is that if journalism isn't doing the job, we need other things that can do the job. And this does have a foothold at helping us to understand our city in a new way. I believe that ultimately network data is as important a human need as a free press was until today. So, again, if we don't put the hands in the power of the people, it'll end up in the hands of others. The next time you want to go click like or follow, ask yourself, how am I going to get access to this information? How am I going to get access to this data set that I'm helping to create? So if you'd like to help, you can go to peoplemaps.org. We're aggregating a lot of data there. I'm having conversations with a lot of people in the data space around trying to drive this agenda forward. I think it's hugely important for the future of our cultures. I think we can start to look at things like segregation and diversity and the kinds of interventions that we can take in our cities to really change them for the better and not for the worse, because you can imagine how data like this could be used in a place like Syria to make things much for the worse. So we have to take ownership of this as people, and I think it's tremendously hopeful that the kinds of uprisings that we've seen around the world did take place, that people realize that they do have the power to command a crowd in their pocket, but we have to take it to the next step. I believe that if we can document and map the connections and the relationships in our cities, we might just have a chance at creating the kinds of cities that we'd like to have. Thank you.